Singapore, a rich, beautiful garden city, the gem of Asia. Let's look under the hood of LEE Kuan Yew's success story. To control the mind of the citizenry, you first have to control the media. Is it any wonder why Reporters Without Borders ranked Singapore 141st out of 167 countries? The destruction of independent media goes back a long way. As early as 1959, when LEE Kuan Yew came to power, the editor-in-chief of the then Independent Straits Times, Leslie Hoffman, foresaw that LEE would rein in the press. It didn't take long for Hoffman's prediction to come to pass. Hoffman fled the country, and the Straits Times was reconstituted to become a mouthpiece for the government. In addition, LEE forced the closure of the Utusan Melayu, the Nanyang Siangpao, the Singapore Herald, the New Nation, the Singapore Monitor, and a host of independent presses. By the turn of the 1980s, the control of the press in Singapore was complete. All local presses now come under the government-managed Singapore Press Holdings. The current president of Singapore and a crony of LEE Kuan Yew, S.R. Narvin, was a chair of SPH from 1982. Succeeding him was Lim Kim San, former Minister for the Interior and Defense. Today, former Deputy Prime Minister Tony Tan is chair. When SPH appointed their first president in 1995, was it any wonder that the former chief of the Internal Security Department, Jong Ik Min, was chosen? Not contented with the wielding of control through SPH's leadership alone, the PAP government planted ears and eyes amongst its journalistic staff. One such person is Chua Lee Hung, a senior political correspondent who was an intelligence officer and an assistant director of the Ministry of Home Affairs. Pranay Gupte, a New York-based journalist who once worked for the Straits Times under Chua Lee Hung, commented that the former ISD officer lacked journalistic experience. A byproduct of such an enmeshment between the PAP and SPH is the identification and co-option of PAP cronies into the ranks of the PAP. Cabinet Minister Ma Bo Tan, the Speaker of the House, Abdullah Tamugi, Senior Minister of State for Foreign Affairs, Zainal Abidin, Senior Parliamentary Secretary, Hawazi Daipi, and PAP MPs Irene Ng and Sing Han Tong were all absorbed from the SPH. Conversely, people who fell out of favor with the government either left or were asked to leave. Foreign press was not spared the bridle. Unlike the local media, though, foreign press cannot be easily controlled through editors and journalists. LEE Kuan Yew was not perturbed, however. He told Derek Davis, a former editor of the Far Eastern Economic Review, that he would hit the foreign press where it hurts, their pockets. Hence the beginning of a long series of libel suits in which the Asian Wall Street Journal, Bloomberg, the International Herald Tribune, Business Week, The Economist, and the Far East Economic Review paid hefty settlements and had their distributions curtailed. Other forms of media also came under the scoop. Radio and television stations, films and internet broadcast on political, religious and social issues came under the scrutiny of the government through licensing and other censorship. Even the lyrics of choirs are to be vetted by the authorities. Films banned, and flyers disallowed. Of course, the control of information alone isn't enough if you want to be a despo. You've got to have a secret police too. The Internal Security Act was introduced by the British in 1948 as part of the emergency regulations arising from a response to communist uprising. The ISA allows the authorities to arrest anyone deemed a threat to national security without evidence or warrant. ISA detainees can be held indefinitely without trial. After the emergency was declared over in 1960, LEE continued to use this brutal law, but for a different purpose. The targets now shift from communists to LEE's political opponents and dissent. In LEE's first big campaign, codenamed Operation Cold Store, he cowardly rounded up about 130 of his most feared political adversaries. Among whom was Lim Hock Siu, who was detained for 19 years, and Syed Zahari, 17 years. Incidentally, Martin C's interview with Zahari was banned in Singapore, even though it had been screened in film festivals all over the world.
Well, I said, Mr. Han, I think I have a choice. I refuse to cooperate. Come what may, I say something like that, you know. All right, you want to be tough, huh? You know that your life can be in danger also if you're taking a very tough line. You know that you can even get killed, is it? And you know that we can release you in the middle of the night, and that as you were walking in the road, we can push you from behind, and I can shoot you from behind, finish. You're finished, Syed. This is where LEE Kuan Yew has always been collaborating with the British to make sure that his political power can be retained. Without the British support, LEE Kuan Yew has no chance of doing that. But LEE Kuan Yew, being LEE Kuan Yew, he always wants to show that he is the great leader. He wants to show his toughness. But now we all know, after reading the declassified document from the record office in London, open to the public. I've read bundles of them in the recent years. We know that LEE Kuan Yew, even the British said LEE Kuan Yew is actually a coward. And I have been saying that LEE Kuan Yew is a coward, a political coward. So you see, it is was under this.
The ISA was also used on Chia Tai Po, who was imprisoned for 32 years, 5 years more than Nelson Mandela.
I had never been a member of any Communist Party, and I had never advocated violence, let alone been charged in court for offense, for any offense of violence.
In 1974, Tan Wah Piao and other student leaders of the University of Singapore Students' Union organized events that called for the release of the ISA detainees. For his effort, Tan was arrested and jailed for a year for inciting riots. He is presently living in exile in London, where he practices law. In 1987, 22 members of the Roman Catholic Church, social activists, and professionals were detained under the ISA. Former Solicitor General Mr. Francis Siao represented one of the detainees, Ms. Chiu So Lung. When Mr. Siao attempted to visit Ms. Chiu at the Whitley Detention Centre, he himself was detained and tortured by the ISD for more than 2 months.
If he thought he had cowed me by detaining me in prison for 72 days, then he's got me all wrong. He thinks that I'm like one of his guys, that they're all scared of him. They are, you know. It's amazing. All these ministers in the cabinet, every one of them is literally scared of him. That what he might say about certain things they do. It's quite pathetic. I've seen this in action when I was Solicitor General, and I'm seeing it still today. All these ministers, every single one of them is not worth the money they're being paid because they're all scared of him to do the right thing, to do the right thing by the people of Singapore. And that is how he holds his ministers all in awe of him. It's quite pathetic. I've seen this happening. Likewise, many of the senior government officers, they are all literally scared of him. What would he say? What would he say? I said, what the hell do you care what he says? If you think it's right, do it. This is the man whom everybody fears. Sad. That is sad for Singapore.
In December 2001, 21 alleged JI members were arrested for their alleged involvement in a plan to attack several embassies based in Singapore. To date, these men have not yet been charged. On 27th February 2008, one of the detainees, Mas Selamat Kastari, reportedly escaped from custody under some incredible circumstances. Information released by the Ministry of Home Affairs was slow, scanty, and conflicting. It was impossible for the public to know what had really transpired. For instance, the public were warned that Kastari was a dangerous man. Later, however, we were told that Kastari did not pose an immediate danger. Today, PAP leaders do not use the ISA on their political opponents anymore. The PAP has found a more sophisticated way to quell those whom they think threaten their power. Defamation suits. In all, LEE Kuan Yew and his cronies have sued his political opponents for defamation and won, of course, a total in excess of $10 million. Some of his notable defendants include Mr. J.B. Jeyaretnam, Mr. Tang Liang Hong, and Dr. Chee Soon Juan of the Singapore Democratic Party.
I must tell you what LEE is reported to have said the day after I entered Parliament. I was elected, rather. He told the then President Devan Nair over lunch that he was determined to make me crawl to him on my bended knees, and he would do that. The man was a champion of free speech and assembly. But the moment he took power, he changed completely. And he became Machiavellian. He must have read Machiavelli and digested everything. And he decided that, you know, if he was to stay in power, he had to control every single thing in Singapore. I think LEE Kuan Yew has been absolutely corrupted by his love of power. And so he stamps down anyone who he sees as a threat to him.
PAP came into power in 1959. It didn't take long for the first PM of the country, LEE Kuan Yew, to begin purging his left-leaning colleagues, among whom was Lim Chin Siong. Lim, according to some historical analysts, would have been the Prime Minister if not for Lee's foul play. After leaving the PAP, Lim Chin Siong led his colleagues to form the Barisan Socialists and readied themselves for the next election in 1963. However, prior to the election, in Operation Cold Store, LEE had the entire leadership of Barisan Socialists arrested under the ISA. With his greatest threat out of the way, LEE went on to build an authoritarian machinery to ensure his total and perpetual hold on Singapore. Some of his machinations include the total control of the press. During elections, media reports were nothing more than a mouthpiece for the PAP. The amendment of the Constitution to curtail rights of citizens, such as the rights to freedom of expression and assembly. Placing the election department under the direct control of the Prime Minister's office. The secret redrawing of constituency boundaries and revealing them only days before the elections. The reduction of rally period to a mere 8-day event. The imposition of a hefty election deposit, currently priced at $13,500 per candidate. The concoction of group representative constituencies, where 6 or 7 constituencies are contested as one GRC. In addition to embedding unfair mechanisms into the election system, the PAP has never hesitated to use, or rather abuse, public resources either to threaten or to bribe the electorate. It has, during several elections, threatened to withhold or delay public projects, such as housing and transportation developments or upgradings, if constituents voted against the PAP. In some elections, public funds were used as a sweetener to buy votes. Just before the 2006 elections, a 2.6 billion handout was announced. Was that a progress package or a vote for PAP package? If these didn't work, then the electorate were threatened with military intervention. As if that is not nefarious enough, the PAP has never failed to hit its opponents below the belt at every election.
Their job is to make life miserable for me so that I screw up and they can come in and sit where I am here, and I'm going to spend all my time, I have to spend all my time thinking what is the right way to fix them, what's the right way to buy my own supporters over.
While opposition candidates had to mind every iota of the Parliamentary Elections Act, PAP candidates enjoyed preferential treatment. When PM Goh Chok Tong and a few ministers unlawfully entered a polling station during the 1997 election, Attorney General Chan Sek-kyung refused to prosecute them. And while political videos and podcasts are banned, the PAP generally enjoys similar exposure via the media. Is there free and fair election in Singapore? You be the judge. Why is freedom of speech and assembly important? Without freedom of speech and assembly, citizens cannot exercise their right to vote effectively or take part in public decision-making if they do not have free access to information and ideas and are not able to express their views freely. Freedom of speech, accordingly, aids the public in holding the government accountable. With free expression, the public is exposed to opinions which are contrary to or critical of the government. Also, the government is all the more unable to conceal official misconduct and solely promote party lines to the exclusion of all other views in attempts to stay in office. Without freedom of speech and assembly, we will always be servants and tools of the government. Without it, we find ourselves in this situation where ministers pay themselves millions of dollars while at the same time withhold our hard-earned CPF savings. Without it, while PAP leaders do the hip-hop, our elderly have to clean toilets, sell packets of tissue, work at the hawker center, and collect cans and cardboard boxes for a living. The Constitution of Singapore guarantees its citizens the rights to the freedoms of speech and assembly. The PAP government knows the important role freedom of speech and assembly plays in empowering the people, something they do not like, and that is why they spare no effort to suppress it. When Chee Soon Juan and Gandhi Ambalam tried to speak up for the rights and plight of workers at a planned Labour Day rally outside the Istana, they were promptly arrested.
We want to tell everybody, Singaporeans as well as everybody else in the world, that in this day and age of an independent labour movement that will speak up on it for the rights of workers is crucial.
Let the whole world see right now what is going on.
They were here to have peaceful.
We are peaceful and non-violent. Look at the way that the PAP government has unleashed the police force to handle the leader of the opposition party. The PAP police is armed to the teeth. We are unharmed. We are defenseless.
Sorry, sir.
After that event, to curb freedom of speech and assembly further, the PAP government added more ridiculous laws to the already stifling ones. The judiciary weighs in to further the executive's wishes. High Court Judge V.K. Raja ruled that Singaporeans do not have the right to picket public institutions because to do so would be to question the institution's integrity and cast a slur on their reputation. District Judge Terence Chua ruled that 5 is no magic number. Smaller groups can also be implicated through guilt by association. 6 Falun Gong practitioners were convicted even though they were displaying placards at different locations.
Money, 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 must be funny in the ring. a rich man's world.
Given the complete control that the PAP has had over Singaporeans, is it any wonder that many of us feel powerless, voiceless, helpless, and even fearful? That is exactly what an authoritarian government wants its society to believe. The PAP wants nothing better than for us to be at their utter mercy and to feel powerless to bring change to Singapore. However, the reality is, we do have a voice. We can help ourselves, and we do have the power. The only question is, do we want to exercise them? And if so, how? A group of democracy advocates have been conducting workshops in Singapore to teach and train Singaporeans on how to empower ourselves and to embark on peaceful civil action to engage this government. Commonly known as civil disobedience, scores of the world's leaders have engaged in this form of non-violent action to free those who lived under the oppression of authoritarians. In modern history, Luminaries such as Mahatma Gandhi and Martin Luther King Jr. have called for and used peaceful civil disobedience to set their peoples free from oppression. Asia's most famous Democrat, Daw Aung San Suu Kyi, has been arrested by the murderous Burmese junta several times for defying the regime's unjust laws. In Singapore, the PAP government has tried to demonize legitimate peaceful protests by etching in our minds images of havoc and chaos. It enforces despotic laws to prohibit public gatherings of more than four. It makes speaking to a public crowd illegal unless a permit is obtained. Its common refrain of maintaining public orderliness is getting tiresome and obsolete, and Singaporeans are beginning to see through this smokescreen. Although small and disparate, groups of people in Singapore have begun to realize the power of peaceful protests to engage and challenge the government. But why is the PAP so bent on preventing people from getting together to express our discontent or to raise public awareness in an orderly and peaceful manner? Are they really afraid that such gatherings will erupt into violence? The truth is, the government knows that people feel empowered, emboldened, and strong when we physically come together. It knows that when people synergize their efforts and actions, we are strong enough to bring real and lasting changes to the country.
I take part in these protests because protests are a legitimate way of the people coming out to voice their dissent, voice their dissatisfaction with the way things are being done in Singapore. And contrary to what the government would have us believe, there's nothing wrong with protests. In fact, the right of the freedom of assembly is in fact granted to us under the Constitution, and it is the government that is constantly altering the laws and changing the rules to deny Singaporeans their right of assembly and freedom of speech.
Last time I used to think or depend on the opposition in the parliament to actually speak up for us, but as I become more politically aware, I realised that they are not really speaking up enough for the people. That is why I decided to step forward and speak up for myself instead.
Okay, the objective of civil activists is to get the government to pay attention to the things which they wish to draw attention to. And civil disobedience is a way to do so, because usually if you were to speak up mainly simply by way of discussion, forum participation, or by debate, you do not see a strong reaction from the authorities. But if you do take it to the level of civil disobedience, be it protests, be it demonstrations, be it petitions, that itself will provoke a reaction from the authorities, and that itself is also a sign, that reaction from the authorities is a sign that the government is rattled by what you do.
Much as LEE Kuan Yew and his followers would like us to believe, non-violent protests are not Western concepts, nor will they necessarily degenerate into chaos. In Asia, people have rallied peacefully by the thousands to challenge human rights abuses and violations by governments. Our Malaysian neighbours have shown that peaceful mass protests and demonstrations can pressure the government into making necessary changes for the people. You may be asking yourselves, but in Singapore, a gathering of five or more is considered illegal and therefore breaking the law. This is when Singaporeans must distinguish just laws from unjust laws. If Rosa Parks had not defied an unjust law, the blacks in America today may still be relegated to sitting behind in buses. If political activists in Taiwan had not confronted the oppressive government, Chiang Ching-kuo would not have lifted martial law, paving the way to Asia's leading democracy that Taiwan is today. Breaking the law isn't always wrong. Some laws are enforced by the government not for the good of the people, but to perpetuate its power or injustice. In such cases, it is not only right for citizens to break the law, but even their duty to do so. What can Singaporeans do to ensure that the PAP government hears and heeds the voices of the people? Demand free and fair elections. Demand for a free and pluralistic media. Keep yourselves informed by reading alternative sources of news. Exercise our constitutional rights to freedom of speech and peaceful assembly. Attend workshops organized by advocacy groups. Speak to your friends and family. Encourage them to do their part to stand up for themselves and others. Unless and until Singaporeans exercise their rights and participate more actively in the decision-making processes, the PAP will continue to come up with policies that do not benefit and are in fact detrimental to Singaporeans. Singaporeans should be proud of the country they live in. But as long as the PAP government continues to make use of its citizens instead of serving them, loyalty and patriotism will remain as mere concepts. As Singaporeans, we must participate in all facets of life in this tiny city. This includes social, cultural, economic, and political arenas. It is only when we feel our voices are heard and that we matter do we feel that we belong to Singapore.
We, the citizens of Singapore, pledge ourselves as one united people.
regardless of race, language or religion. Build a democratic society based on justice and equality so as to achieve happiness, prosperity and progress for our nation. We shall overcome. We shall overcome. We shall overcome someday.
Oh,